one whom Jesus loved and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Dear friends in Christ, grace and peace to you from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. As many of you know from firsthand experience, it's always a little risky to make a generalization, but I'm going to make one this morning anyway, and here it is. There's a very good chance that you, or someone in your family, or someone that you know, has been touched by death in the last 6 to 12 months. You have buried a loved one, a parent, a grandparent, a family member, perhaps, a friend, a child, or maybe even a spouse. You have gone to a funeral. You have read about death in the paper, or you have watched it on the news. My goodness, even last night at the 10 o'clock news, the first four stories were about someone who had died or been killed. Like taxes, death touches us all. And if you are one of those people of whom I have made a generalization about this morning, then it's also a safe bet that you are thinking about the person who has died as you come to worship on this Easter Sunday morning. One could even say it is death that has drawn you to this place today in order for you to hear once again, or maybe even to hear for the first time, the Easter message that death has been swallowed up in victory by the resurrection of Jesus. You will notice in the text today that the Easter story as told by John begins with death. the way John tells this part of the story, it feels like I am hearing it in real time. It is honest, and I can easily connect with what Mary is feeling as she goes to the tomb on that morning, searching for a body. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran, and she went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." She must have looked inside the tomb, and seeing nothing, she assumes that the body has been moved. Mary cannot see beyond her grief, because, as you all know, death has a way of narrowing our vision and our ability to see. Plus, we need to remember that her heart is broken. She watched Jesus die and was there when he was taken off the cross. Death is what draws her to the tomb. Then she does something interesting. Thinking the body has been moved, she goes to Peter and the other disciple. She instinctively seeks out community, and this is where the story begins to change. Peter and the other disciple, they race to the tomb. The other disciple gets there first, looks inside, sees the linen wrappings, but doesn't go in. Peter arrives, and ever the impetuous one, he goes right into the tomb. He sees the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up and set in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, he also goes in, and he sees and he believes. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. No body, no angels, just an empty tomb, and they believed. They didn't understand the scriptures that Jesus must be raised from the dead, but they believed. I can relate to that. I find it to be helpful that belief doesn't always have to mean that we understand. There is much of how God is at work in this world and in my life that I don't understand, yet I still believe. Faith begins at the empty tomb for Peter and the other disciple. Belief in God's power over death begins. They don't understand, but they believe, and that only happens when God is at work. This is Easter faith. To believe without having to always understand is what happens when the power of the resurrection is at work in us. This is what makes it possible. This is what makes it possible for us to stand at the grave of a loved one and in the midst of our tears and our heartache to know that death is not the end and that our mourning shall be turned into dancing. This is what makes it possible to keep on living when death and darkness seem to have an upper hand. One of the closing prayers that we use in our funeral liturgy here at Augustana says this. This is the prayer. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Because he lives, we shall live also. That's the prayer. That's the confession. This is the power of the resurrection at work in our lives. This is Easter. We may not understand it, but we believe it. I've been touched by the witness of the Warwick family out of Wilmer, Minnesota. You recognize the name? You read the papers? On April 9th, the young man who killed 79-year-old Lila Warwick was sentenced to life in prison without parole for his role in her death. Lila was 79, and Lila was a Christian. He Before Lila died, she told the young man who took her life that she could help him, that God would help him. That's what she said to him. Unfortunately, he didn't listen. Lila's daughter said this to the young man who took her mother's life in her impact statement. She said, and I quote, "Despite every graphic and appalling word I've heard and witnessed, I do not hate. Returning hatred for hatred and evil for evil, she would not, nor will I. In this I will honor her." Lila's granddaughter said this, "Even though this man took away her life, I refuse to let him take a portion of mine. I love you, Grandma. I can't wait to see you in heaven." These people are Christians. And they know that because he lives, we shall live also. That's what these statements are. They're statements of life. They're statements of resurrection. This is what it means to respond in this manner is only possible in the light and the hope of the resurrection. And as many of you know from firsthand experience, sometimes it's hard to see it. Really hard. You know that. And you live it. Our vision is cloudy and our struggles are real. There is not a person here this morning that isn't feeling and seeing the darkness of some kind of death at work in their life. But the good news is that you are here. You have come to see for yourself that the tomb is empty. You have come to sing the Alleluias. In spite of the darkness and the death, you may not understand it, and it may even be a struggle for you to believe it, but you are here in the company of all these people, and we are saying together, because he lives, we shall live also. Because he lives, a mother and a granddaughter can stand in the courtroom and face the young man who took the life of a loved one and declare, "I will not hate, I will not return evil for evil." This is the power of the resurrection at work. What else could it be? Because he lives, we can face the death of our loved ones and keep on living. Because he lives, we can face the hard decisions that have to be made and keep on living. Because he lives, we can see the resurrected Jesus standing in our midst, calling us by name and giving us peace. A peace that passes human understanding. And the faith to declare once more that Christ is risen. Alleluia. He is risen indeed. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
presence today, and we pray that the message of Easter this morning, in word and in song and in community, will bring you new life and joy. We are grateful for all who visit with us here at Augustana this morning. Thank you for choosing Augustana as your place to hear the good news that Christ has been raised from the dead. Just a couple of quick announcements. If you are delivering an Easter lily to one of our homebound members, you can pick them up at noon today, or you can do it tomorrow. Thank you for sharing in this ministry of caring for those unable to be here with us today. We are also grateful for our musicians this morning. We also say a word of thanks to the ushers and the acolytes and those who help make the sanctuary so festive and beautiful. The lilies and the flowers are wonderful. I think we can safely say, friends, spring has arrived on Easter this year. We have a tradition here at Augustana on Easter Sunday that we close with the singing of the Hallelujah Chorus. And we invite anyone who would like to join the choir to do so, to come and sing with them. Kathy has music up front here. Have the women stand in front of the choir. Okay, those are the instructions. The men can go to the sides. Is that right, Kathy? All right. So we have music for you. Please come forward. Find your place. Sopranos over there, altos over there, tenors and basses. And lift your voice in praise. And don't forget to watch the conductor right at the end, especially. May your Easter celebrations be filled with grace and joy as you gather with family and friends on this very special day. And on behalf of Pastor Ferguson and our intern, Daniel Weinhardt, and my wife and I, and the whole staff here at Augustana, we wish you a most blessed and joy-filled day. Our worship continues with receiving today's offering.
Bless your people in every nation and unite your children as we celebrate the joy and hope we find because your Son has defeated death. Make us to live as people made bold by the promise of Easter, sharing the news that he is risen with all the world. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O God, the resurrection of your Son means life for every nation. Show us that promise and hope. Heal nations scarred by oppression, injustice, war, conflict, scandal, disease, and death. Give hope to those ravaged by violence. May your name be sung by all who share you in love and service around the world, especially Martha and Linda Jacobson. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God, your Son healed all who were hurting and in distress. Bless those who heal and show compassion in Jesus' name, and grant your healing presence to those who need you on this day, especially Diane Eunice, Judy Johnson, Bob Bankin, June Michalonic, Elijah Philippi, Jan Wheaton, Janet Hogan, Dave Pickett, Renee Lowen, Russell Agrimson, Nicholas Smallage, Tori Smith, Diane Schmidt, Jane Ditberger, Diane Jensek, and Pat Kilbane. Lord, in your mercy. O God, we give thanks for the saints whose lives proclaim the victory of your love. With them, give us courage to follow our crucified and risen Lord until all things are gathered in his name. May we find peace in your promises even as we mourn our loved ones, and make your promises real for all who face death, especially Mary Schwab and her family on the death of her brother John Moore. Lord, in your mercy. O God, because your Son lives, all that which was dark in our lives is now brought to light. Give us confidence to share your word as we go forth from this place, together with our sisters and brothers in Humble Walk, Pueblo de Fe, San Agustin, Isidoro, and Niampanga. May we make Christ known in all we say and do. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our crucified and risen Savior, who taught us to pray, our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The God of life, who raised Jesus from the bonds of death, who sends forth the Spirit to renew the face of the earth, be merciful to you and bless you now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.